live, we are live. Okay, can you hear me? Oh, wait.
We're live, but we're not loud.
My bad, I thought it was wrong, my bad. Anyway, she's alive already, just called.
You're live?
I'm alive.
Okay, so Pastor, will you do prayer for us? Please, pretty please.
Who's that?
Pastor.
Oh, see, I misunderstood you. Well, I can do that.
Yeah.
If I can remember how to turn on her mics, there we go. All right.
Well, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for a beautiful day, a beautiful Sabbath day that you've given us to come rest, but also to hear a wonderful message on health and how we can just watch, be prepared and watch for our health and increase it. But Lord, we're just truly grateful that you're with us and in our presence, and we love you and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, so my topic this evening is preventing viral illnesses naturally. Now, there are lots of illnesses that are caused by viruses, tons of them. A lot of them were vaccinated during childhood, like the polio, measles, rotavirus, hepatitis, B, C, all of those. HIV, there's nothing for that. But today I'm going to focus on the influenza virus and the cold viruses, because we're in flu season, which started in October and it goes through April. So for those who haven't had their flu shots yet, we need to do our flu shot. Which one goes up?
Push it up.
Push
it up.
Do it on your computer.
Yeah, we have to.
It's fine. I have these slides here anyway. I'm reading from some.
It's got a viral illness.
It's a viral. It caught a virus. You know, like electronics, they get viruses, so we do get viruses. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay, so pretty much, you know, viruses, they're microscopic. We can't see them. They're everywhere. And usually, we're healthy enough where certain viruses will not affect us. You know, we go through them every day. They don't affect us. But there are other people who are vulnerable, like those who have chronic illnesses, the older, the so it's at two spectrums. The very old, the very young, and then those that are, Pastor, I see you laughing and looking around when I said the very old. So it'll affect those that are very old, the very young, and those that are immunocompromised. So like people with chronic illnesses, like asthmatics or autoimmune diseases, those are the people who viruses will affect. So we will look at the influenza virus at first, since we're in flu season. As I said, that started October to April, and there is a vaccine, which some people don't take the vaccine. I do take the vaccine. Why? My whole family got the flu 1 year in Thanksgiving, and there were some visitors with us. The whole house actually got the flu. Even the visitors got the flu, and that was a bad Thanksgiving for us. And the funny thing was, like my family, we were vaccinated, so our flu symptoms were 24 hours. Little bit of fever, you know, feeling a little achy, but by 24 hours, we were over it. The little boy who was with us, he was in bed for a straight week because he was not vaccinated for the flu. So even though some people say they do get the flu with the vaccine, the period is usually shorter. And they usually advise that those who are, you know, chronic illnesses, the very young, the very old, And I'm looking at Pastor to get a flu vaccine.
I thought you were looking at me with expression when you said older.
No, that was me.
Oh, was that it?
Him, yes. So pretty much it spread through sneezing and coughing. So, you know, you'll see these campaigns on the television which says, you know, cover your cough, cover your sneeze, sneeze in your elbows. If you have the virus, 24 to 48 hours, even before you know you have it, you can be shedding it. So I may be here, I may look healthy, I've been exposed, I'm here talking and sneezing on everybody, and I'm gonna get sick 2 days later, and then people here will get sick again, and it's just like a continuous cycle. So you'll see the campaigns that talk about cover your cough and cover your sneeze. So some of the symptoms when you get the flu, of course, it's a high fever, which usually goes up to 104. The muscle aches, joint pain, headache, just not feeling well. Some people will have a cough, a sore throat, some sort of GI symptoms, sometimes, you know, nausea, vomiting, sometimes some diarrhea will come with the flu. And it usually runs a course of over a week. We say it's self-limiting, so it's gonna run its course, but the fact is it makes you feel bad. So usually, in the healthcare setting, we will usually treat symptoms. So we will usually say, take something for your fever, we will say, you know, whatever you have in cough, we'll give for that. But it's really just supportive and symptomatic care. Now, there is an antiviral that they'll usually prescribe sometimes for the flu called Tamiflu. It really just shortens the course by 2 days. And it's a very expensive drug. And you have to get in there before 48 hours, by 48 hours of symptoms in order for you to even get the Tamiflu. And when you do get it, it shortens it by 2 days. And you spend up to $100 out of pocket for this medicine. So really, just let it run its course. Because you'll feel better. It's gonna go away. So it's self-limiting. Of course, we'll just look at the common cold too. So, as you see, there are over 200 subtypes of viruses, and these are the most common ones up there, and it kind of tells you when they're around. So like the rhinovirus, and that one you'll get a lot of nasal symptoms, rhinorrhea, lots of runny nose, stuffiness. That one usually spring to late fall, and this one causes up to 50% of the common case of colds. Then, of course, you have the coronavirus, and that one is winter to spring. You have the parainfluenza, which is spring to late fall. The RSV, which is winter to spring, and this one affects young children a lot. You get children being hospitalized because of the respiratory syncytial virus. And then, of course, you have the adenovirus, which affects like institutions, hospitals, daycares, and military. And then you have the enterovirus, which is in summer. So pretty much, if you look, pretty much all the seasons are covered. There is, you know, some sort of viral illness that will be, regardless of when we are. And of course, the same thing, transmission, you know, hand contact, the safe sneezing, coughing. For the cold virus, they will remain for up to 2 hours. So say I sneeze in my hand 2 hours ago at home and I didn't wash my hands. And I come here and I shake hands with everybody 2 hours later, then I can be transmitting the virus. And there are people who actually don't shake hands. They're now doing this kind of elbow bump or something like that. Right, Thomas? And of course, and the rhinovirus, that one also survived even on surfaces for a long, long period of time. So it's usually sneezing, coughing, you know, hands, and that kind of thing. And of course, symptoms in the common cold, dry, scratchy throat, runny nose, stuffy nose, you're gonna get a lot of stuff up here. Fever is really rare in adults with a cold, a cough, and that kind of thing. And as I said, usually the viral illnesses, the treatment is symptomatic care. So when we talk about prevention, the biggest prevention is hand washing. You have to wash your hands. And we can't say that enough. In healthcare, you know, if you walk around the hospitals, you see all these little foam bottles everywhere. They're encouraging you to, if you can't wash your hands physically, to at least get a hand sanitizer or something with alcohol. hand washing. That definitely prevents a lot of the cases. And of course, you know, covering the cough and sneeze. We said sneeze in your elbows, you know, not in the atmosphere, because that sneeze, it propels those viruses far away. And all it has to do is get on somebody's mucous membranes and you're in trouble. Of course, we talk about exercise. You know, they say if you exercise, you're a little, you know, less likely to get a viral illness because your body will be a little bit more, you know, you're a little bit more fit, so to speak. Of course, it says you have to get enough sleep, okay? Sleep is important. Same time every night, no caffeine, no tea, you know, let it be quiet.
No caffeine.
No caffeine, no tea. Yes, those are the things that, even if you take it in the daytime, it will disrupt your sleep at night. And of course, you know, hydration, lots of water, no teas, no sodas. And looking at my research, I found it interesting that it talks about, you know, cleanliness of your environment. Okay, so I'm from the islands. And usually, you know, I guess we don't have seasons. So our doors and windows and everything is always open. You know, we have a lot of fresh air. My windows, even now at home, I have screen doors, I open them. Every morning if I'm home, my screen doors are open and my things are down with my mesh up all the time because I have to get that fresh air. So, you know, I found that living here with the air conditioning, everybody just kind of locks themselves in that dark house. It's cold and it's dark and it's like the best place for viruses. They love it. Okay, they hate the sunshine. They hate the fresh air. So if you can imagine you're sick, and what we do when we're sick, close the blinds, get the place cold, cover up. We're sneezing all over the room. We're wiping with our tissues, we're throwing them by the bedside. Can anybody relate to that? How are you gonna get better? You're just circulating everything in that room. You're inhaling the viruses. You're just there. So we have to keep our surroundings clean. We have to open those windows and doors. You know, get some sunshine in, get some fresh air in. I mean, even if you have to turn that AC off. Okay, so sunlight actually is a very, very good antimicrobial agent. I know it's free. You can't, you don't have to buy it. Okay, it kills germs. Okay, and it says if you get 20 minutes of sunshine per week, it's not saying daily, per week, you can have an effect for 3 weeks. Okay. Because it does increase the body's resistance to infection. It reduces the incidence of colds. It boosts the mood.
Play more golf.
You know, play more golf. There we go. Because it increases, you know, that serotonin, which, you know, boosts your mood, makes you feel good. And, of course, you know, sunshine helps with the production of vitamin D. And that vitamin D actually helps the white blood cells to produce these germ-killing compounds that destroy the viruses. So, you know, I know you're sick, you want to be inside, you want to be hunkered down in the dark, you know, just having your tissues all around you, but get up, clean the place up, get outside, open the windows. And that will definitely help with starting the healing process. There are a few remedies which they say will help to boost the immune system and will help you with your flu. So of course everybody hears about vitamin C. Okay, that is kind of one of the most common things that you hear. If you're getting sick, take some vitamin C. It does have a role in preventing the common cold, but it is better, like, for people who, like they say, if you exercise daily and you take your vitamin C daily, you have a better chance than waiting until you're like, oh, my throat is scratchy. Let me take a gram of vitamin C. It doesn't usually work that way. It prefers a long-term use of vitamin C. And of course, you know, you have vitamin C in so many preparations nowadays. You have pills, you have powders. And of course, just eat a good old orange, you know, citrus fruits. that's a natural way to get your vitamin C. Another thing they talk about naturally is elderberry. And that they said has antiviral properties and, you know, affects the immune system. I have a friend who swears by elderberry.
Is that an old raspberry?
I have no clue.
Second cousin.
It's a cousin to the raspberry. not the grandfather. But there are lots of elderberry preparations out there. You can actually buy it in little bottles. I think Sambuca has a really good one that a lot of people swears by. But they say that also helps with help with the immune system. Of course, they talk about echinacea, which, you know, shortens the system, the immune system, but also helps just strengthen the immune system. Red clover is one of the things that they also suggest to help strengthen the immune system. And of course, you know, they always talk about garlic. You know, it's good for the immune system, it's good for blood pressure, it makes your breath smell bad, but it seems to be one of the good germ fighter.
Actually, why it's so effective, because it spreads the distance between people, and therefore decreases the disease.
I really like that because if I have garlic on my breath, you're going to stay away and I won't be able to get my germs on me. So I think that's a very, very, very good one. Pretty much once you get the flu, so now you didn't wash your hands, you get it on your mucous membranes and you're starting to feel real bad. You know, sore throat usually accompanies it. And since I was growing up, my grandma always tells you about a salt water gargle.
Yep.
And it still stands true today. So you can do a salt water gargle for a sore throat. They suggest using a humidifier in your room. Those are available commercially pretty cheap. What we will tell moms is sometimes that those who they can't afford a humidifier and their kids are really stuffy, we will say, turn the shower on real hot and close the door and get that bathroom real steamy and then just bring the kid in and sit there. And that will usually help to open up the passages and help that liquefy that mucus and get them going again. Vaseline around the nose, you know, after you've blown your nose and have all that bunch of tissue there, your nose starts to get sore and red. So they say Vaseline around the nose, you know, and this is all viral illnesses. Once you get it, it has to run its course. You know, these things are just to make you more comfortable. And sometimes they'll shorten the duration by a couple of days. But once you get it, you just have to suffer through it, really. Of course, they talk about normal saline nose irrigation. Here we go again with the salt water. Neti pots are a big, big thing these days. And it's really like a little, it reminds me of those genie pots. Have you ever, the pots and the genie, you rub it and the genie comes out. It reminds me of those. But pretty much you put a salty solution in there and you go and you pretty much just irrigate your sinuses and the nostrils and everything, and it prevents that stuffiness, loosens it, and then it comes out. So you don't have that congestion and all that headache and sinus pressure and pain and what the neti pots. Of course, you know about the menthol ointment, you know, the little Vicks on your chest. As kids, we would put it on their feet and put their socks on for babies, because it's usually a little harsh to put it on their chest and their face. And this really does help with relieving all the congestion and all of that stuff. Looking also, of course, you know they always talk about the chicken soup and the hot tea, right? They say you should have chicken soup, and that will help your cold and everything. But really, you know, the whole science behind it, the same way the garlic just keeps people away, then, I mean, the steam, you know, you're over a hot bowl of soup, the steam is going to clear your nasal passages. And, of course, the broth is going to keep you hydrated and help soothe that sore throat. And, you know, of course, you have to stay hydrated once you have cold, especially if you're having, you know, a lot of mucus and you're blowing your nose, you are losing a lot of fluids. When you are dehydrated, you feel bad. When everything is dry, you feel bad. Your lips are going to be dry. They're going to feel chapped. Your eyes are going to be scratchy, because we have to remember the role that water plays in our body. So can you imagine, you take away all that water between your, you know, your drainages, your nasal drainage and all of that. Plus, we have a habit when we're congested to mouth breathe. And so we're losing a lot of liquid there too. So we're mouth breathing, we're draining, okay? If you have a fever, you know, all of that. So you're gonna get really, really dry. So, you know, we can't really underestimate the importance of hydration when you are having a cold, having a fever, having a viral illness. Plus at the same time, if you're well hydrated, then those kidneys are gonna function, okay? And of course, you know, the viruses, they produce byproducts, you know, when they're in our body multiplying, having a party in there, getting you hot, they're letting off all sorts of stuff. So once you start getting your hydration going, then you eliminate some of that through the kidneys, you know, through the urine. You pass more urine, and you will feel better. So you definitely have to hydrate with the viral illnesses. As I said before, they run their course. You just have to wait them out. And then, of course, we can't underestimate the importance of nutrition, okay? Now, when you're sick, do you want to eat?
No.
No, you don't want to eat. So usually, we will tell parents, we'll say, yes, your kid may not want to eat, but they have to drink. So, you know, nobody's going to want to be having a five-course meal if you're sick. But we say, go for light meals, you know, a little broth here, vegetarian, whatever you want to put in there. You know, that salt, it helps a little bit. Lots of fluids. So like for kids, sometimes we'll say, you know, Pedialyte, which is an electrolyte-filled fluid. For adults, we will say, go ahead and Gatorade or Powerade. The sugar content is low, but they do have electrolytes, and you want to replace those electrolytes to help you feel better. Hot tea, they'll say. The warmth actually helps to soothe your throat, so you don't feel as bad, you know, because after you've coughed and coughed and coughed, you end up with a really dry, sore throat, and to me, that's kind of one of the worst parts of going through a viral illness. So they usually say warm tea or warm drink. I have a friend who swears by just lemon water, hot. So she'll get you some water and she'll put lemons in there and make it warm. And that's her remedy. And of course, you can see the value of that, because a lemon has a vitamin C. Okay? So there are a lot of little remedies out there that we think, oh, this may not work. And we think, oh, you know, these are just old wives' tales. But if you break down the different components, you'll see that lemon water will have the vitamin C. You'll see that the chicken broth will actually have the steam and the liquid in it. The Vicks, which, you know, a lot of people don't like the menthol on their chest. It just kind of goes up and opens up those passages and clears you. So, of course, as we said, viral illnesses, we have to just bear with them, right? So in the meantime, you pray and ask God for a shorter course, you know? And you talk about seeking a relationship with Him, and you count your blessings, and, you know, be grateful and be thankful. We have a habit when we're sick and when we're at our worst, We have a tendency to dwell on the negative things. And we have a tendency to go into this woe is me stage, you know, oh, why did this have to happen to me? You know, there are people out there who are not eating as well or not going to church, and they're fine, and I'm here serving, and I'm sick. You know, we, as humans, we tend to go into that little, that woe is me phase.
That's a joke, Samuel.
You know, so we just have to. That is a time, really, that we need to draw closer. That's the time we need to pray. That's the time we need to shore up our relationship and be thankful. Because, you know, mindset to me is a big thing. If you are thinking, oh, I'm just going to die, you know, you're not going to feel much better. If you find something else to focus on or somebody else to focus on, then you find that your spirits are lifted and you will definitely get in a better mood and your body will start to react and to fight this thing. You know, it was interesting this morning when the pastor said, you know, people with friendships or good friends, they, you know, rebound better from things. This is a part of it to me. You know, if you have a positive mindset, you will rebound faster. You will get over it quicker. You won't have the time to sit there and go, woe is me. You will, you know, you'll give your body that chance to fight these viral illnesses.
Careful, it might be you one day.
And you know, and that is the problem. You sometimes don't know who gives you the virus. There was a story recently on Facebook, and it was sad. It was a couple who had a young child. This baby may have been under one. They were getting married, and the baby was at the wedding. And, you know, people have a tendency to kiss kids. And this baby ended up with a herpes virus.
Oh.
And ended up dying. So as I said, viruses, they affect the very young.
Yeah.
And the very old and the immunocompromised. Now, you know, listening to this mom, she said, I'm bringing awareness to this situation. They had no clue who had the virus. You know, because you know, you have these little fever blisters and everything. And what she was saying was she kept going through her mind thinking, who could have given her baby this virus? Who could have kissed her baby and got this virus on her? She was young, her immune system was not ready to fight. And she said, I'm just bringing awareness to this because I had to stop trying to think who did this.
Yeah.
I had to stop trying to go back through my mind because it was driving me crazy. Just to think, who was at that wedding? Who kissed my child? And this was a first child, an only child, you know, and that was sad. And this is a viral illness. And this was the herpes virus that took this little baby girl by. So, you know, and her mindset was what got my attention. The fact that she said, you know, I just don't want any other parent to have to go through this. Because I have to stop myself from thinking who. And it could be somebody very close to me who kissed the baby and this happened. So this is just another thing with viral illnesses. Another thing, as I was talking about opening up the doors and the windows and getting the fresh air in, there is this hospital in Jamaica. It's called the National Chest Hospital. All they do is chest conditions. And it was built at a time when tuberculosis was big, you know, in the islands and stuff like that. And the thing that fascinates me about this hospital is this. It is opened up. Like, you go through, there's a big door. There's a big door to bring the air in. And every bed is by a window. And these aren't windows that you close. These are the big windows that you just open up. And all the air comes through the hospital. And it was designed specifically that way to help those patients who had chest conditions, tuberculosis, any sort of lung cancer. It's called it National Chest, and that's where you go for pneumonias, bronchitis. Anybody who needs hospitalization and need those specialists, you know, those are who are there. And just the design of that hospital was made to show the importance of fresh air on respiratory illnesses and your lungs and everything, the importance of it.
I think they did that, and I think they knew that as early as the late 1800s, was like out in I think Arizona was one of the states that they would send people to, and they would do the same thing, open up these big rooms, and, you know, all day, because Arizona's, you know.
The temperature is good, it's temperate. There was also this story that they told about, there was a flu epidemic in 1919, I think, and the hospitals were overwhelmed, like there were so many people with flu. So what they did was, the army decided to help. And I forgot where in the country this was. It was somewhere cold though. I don't know, Virginia, somewhere. And they brought tents for the overflu, okay? Now these patients were in the tents, and all they got were hot water bottles by their feet to keep them warm, okay? And this is a flu epidemic. And what they found was that the patients who were in the hospital were dying, and the ones in the tents were fine, they were surviving. And they attributed that to the circulation of the fresh air in the tents. And the fact that the ones in the hospital, they were pretty much just locked in, and you know, everything was kind of circulating, the viruses were circulating in there. Yet the ones outside were doing better than the ones inside. So that just goes to show also the importance of fresh air when you have a viral illness. Fresh air, sunshine, hydration, you know, a diet that's gonna provide some nutrients, but doesn't have to be, you know, a big heavy meal, but just something to keep your strength up, and of course, keep moving. You know, so you will rest for a couple of hours, but you're not gonna rest in the dark with your tissues for the whole 24 hours, you know. You haven't even gotten up sometimes to take a shower. You need to get up and take a shower regardless of how bad you're feeling, because you know, that warm water, that steam in that bath, you'd be surprised how much better you usually feel after a nice warm bath, even if you're having the flu or the cold. Right. Any questions? Yes, ma'am.
Well, I was just thinking, there's another natural remedy for a really, really bad sore throat. And what it is the juice of half a lemon, I think it's 2 tablespoons of water, mixed with that, an eighth of a teaspoon of cayenne pepper. Stir it together and gargle it. It's caused by a virus. It'll kill us.
Wow.
I can't even gargle the whole thing. It's so strong, but it works.
There we go.
And ghost pepper, that might help.
and the peppers, you know, they do have all those
medicinal
purpose, you know, yes, it does. As a matter of fact, they were saying even for weight loss, you could, if you eat spicy food, it does increases your metabolism to help you lose weight and stuff like that. Of course, you know, you have the downside to it, where you're going to probably end up with a ulcer if it's too hot. I've also, I know they would do honey for a cold. The worst thing my grandma ever gave me, they would mix honey with cod liver oil. And that's what they would give you for a cold. They'd actually have it, like, in a bottle somewhere fermenting. And the minute you start coughing, they bring it out. So you'd be like, I'm fine, I'm not coughing, I'm okay.
My brother.
No.
It was him.
Because that thing is, it's awful. That cod liver oil, that fishy.
Cod liver oil, period.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's awful. But that was our cold remedy growing up as kids. They would mix that with honey. And you'd get a tablespoonful of it. So, you know, talk about natural remedies. Yeah. All right. Any contributions? Anybody have any remedies? Maria, do you have anything that works for a cold or a flu? Miss Anna, talk about her pepper and water.
Okay. You cover quite a lot. If you have problem breathing, if you buy the peppermint oil, the essential oil, but be sure that you buy the good one. And
what
just
kind of,
put
what kind of oil?
Peppermint oil. I knew that he's giving her that.
Like
and
her
just
Sirocco.
Serotonin.
Serotonin, yeah.
Then just put it around your nose and under nose, but be careful with the eyes because you will tear up because it's strong smell. And other things which I like, she mentioned garlic. And I like to mix actually a full orange, even a grapefruit. Just take the skin out and put it in a blender with garlic, okay, and onion and lemon juice, fresh lemon juice, and a little bit of water, and just blend it. And just take 1 teaspoon once in a while. Very good. Function like a natural antibiotic. Very, very good. When you feel that you come with a cold, just blend those things in it and just take it. Even you can put some drops of peppermint in that mixture. Very, very, very good. And garlic, actually, garlic capsules, because my husband will not kiss me if I eat the raw garlic. But garlic, the capsules, if you take them during the allergy season and when you people are around you with a lot of cold, just take them regularly and you'll see how it will help you to cope with the allergy and with the cold too. For me, it works the allergy, the garlic capsules. Anything? You know what?
Yeah, well,
before I got married and in the beginning of our marriage, I will 4 cloves of garlic, fresh. I will slice them thin and put them between 2 pieces of bread every day I will eat. But let me tell you. Yes?
Yeah, that is not so bad.
He didn't. He told me, you eat garlic and I will not kiss you. You choose which way you go. And guess what? I gave up on garlic. I go on the capsules now. You know, and I'm gaining his kisses.
Well, are you saying that the kiss takes the place of
quality? Well,
pretty good, trust me.
Yeah. He's not that good, don't worry about that.
But that would boost the mood, Willis, you know? And help you to fight that cold. So there might be something for that.
Garlic and honey is a good remedy.
Yeah. Yes. And something else which we did it, you take a big onion and you scoop out the middle and you put honey in it and put that onion to be boiled in a pot. But don't fill a lot of water, just maybe half water reach the onion and let it boil. And that honey gets that phytochemicals from the onion. And when you cough, just take 1 teaspoon every time when you cough. Very, very good. Onion and honey together.
Or you could just, I guess, blend it together.
Yes, you can. You can too.
Well, I heard of one too, though. I'm sure they're Lesson Lewis thing. They take a whole onion, peel it, cut the top off, and set it in the room.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. That's true too. I heard about too.
House is going to smell like
onion. Well, when you are sick anyway, it does not smell good. That's true. That's true too. Look, the natural remedies work. It's just that you have to be a very takes time, and you have to be faithful to them. You know. That's true too. That's true too. Only Maria spoke about the flu shots. I took only one time the flu shots when I was working in the hospital, and the day after I took it, I got sick with cold. And I was like, that's it. I'm not taking anymore. For some people work, but for some people they don't work. Then you have to see, okay, what will work better for me, what will be the best, and so on. Each body reacts or acts differently. Then you cannot really put a protocol for everybody, the same treatment, you know. Even with the medication, and even with the natural remedies, you have to look and see. Now, one time I had a sore throat, cold with a sore throat, and it was so painful even to swallow. How many of you are familiar with golden seal? It's similar with echinacea, okay? I will take the extract, golden seal extract, and I'll put 2 dropperful directly in the throat. It's very bitter, very, very bitter. But every 6 hours I will do it. And in 2 days, everything was clean, everything. Then, when I have those kind of situation, already I know what works with me. And you can try with you and see how it will work. But golden cell is very strong. Now, golden cell, you cannot take it more than 7 days. Okay? It's a natural antibiotic. It's quite strong.
Okay. And of course, you know, the new thing that I have noticed, and even a lot of my colleagues at work, they're using a lot of essential oils to help with viral illnesses and stuff like that. The oilers, as we call them, it's a really big community out there of oilers that use it. As a matter of fact, there is this one oil that I have at home that I use it in the fall months on the kids. I just put it on their soles before bed at night, and it's called Thieves. It is supposed to have a combination of stuff to boost the immune system. And the truth is, since I've started doing that, normally the kids would get sick a couple of times during the fall. It's usually the time when I'm in the pediatrician's office and stuff. And last year we used Thieves, and it really made a difference. So there are lots of essential oils out there that people are using to get away from medicine. They're using them for antibiotics. I think there's even frankincense that they'll use, lavender oil for sleep. There's pretty much oil out there for any ailment, and it's a growing community of oilers out there. You have people who you'll see them walking around with a bag, and they have oil for everything. So, you know.
My pet peeve, I'll go down a rabbit hole just for a second or two here. We have little or no validation, research-wise, for any of this stuff. And for the stuff that, medicines that are not acidic. Thought she was gonna count. For things that are reportedly bad for you, and all medication has a side effect, there is validation for its use. So why is this other than it's good for profit?
Well, you know, they talk about big pharma.
Well, we can go down that road, but let's stay with the essentials. And so even vitamin C, now they're saying that the vitamins that are sold in pharmacies really don't have that much effectiveness.
Yes. And the thing about the herbal industry, as you said, there is not a lot of research to validate it. Now, for drugs to come to the market, you have to do research. So first they start with animal research, and then they'll get it to a certain level, and then they'll do clinical trials on it, and then they'll go through all these loops to get to the FDA to get them approved, and, so they have all this research to bring this up. For some reason, it is lacking in the herbal section, and herbs have been around forever. I mean, medicines are coming from herbs. Yeah. What people are saying, though, is in terms of, say for instance, I say, okay, this plant will help you. How much of it? That's the problem, How much medicine is actually in one of these leaves? So the research is not there. And it is a similar thing, like even with the pediatric population, certain drugs are off-label used. Most drugs are off-label used. If you look at them, they'll say, don't use it in a child under two, under one, because there's no research, because they're not allowing children to participate in clinical trials. It's illegal. So you don't have that. So I don't know what's happening with the herbal, why people can't do the research for it, except to say that maybe there are people who, other drugs are more profitable. So if you get this one to be backed by research, who's going to want to go with the natural remedies,
Yeah.
So big pharma might lose here.
No, but the herbal community themselves can represent themselves. Yeah. And they don't.
Well, because they don't have money.
The money for research.
Yeah.
Well, it takes
FYI,
money.
That's a plastic
big
plant.
Big farmies are going to shut them down because they're going to lose money.
Yeah, I agree.
No, legally they can't do that.
Well, I'm not sure.
Legally, not legally,
How many of you heard about Gerson therapy?
Yeah.
Okay. He wrote a book, 50 Cases Cure of Cancer, and that was in 1950, when was the fight between the chemotherapy and the natural remedies, which one is more effective. The chemotherapy representatives could now prove one cancer to be cured in that time, 1950. Dr. Gerson had a book, 50 Cases, brought it before the Congress. But you have to realize, with the sunshine, you don't have money. With the water, you don't really gain money. With the medication, it's a lot insurance and a lot money. He lost, actually. For this, the Congress went with the chemotherapies instead of with the natural remedies. Even though they had proved 50 cases with the natural remedies, it's the money issue. It's the money.
Yeah, and again, not to be argumentative, and I understand that. In fact, I saw there's a video out about four or five different people over periods of time who have come up with cures for cancer. But at the same time, I personally have tried some of these products, and I have seen no effect.
Yeah.
You know, and I just see my daughters going out the window. That's how I personally feel about it.
There are two distinct communities out there.
Yeah.
You have the ones who are into natural remedies, and you have the medications. For me personally, I work in healthcare, and you could call me a pill pusher because I do give drugs out pretty much every day I work. And I've seen the immediate effect, you know? So say for instance, you know, for a patient who is vomiting, I can get 4 milligrams of Zofran, I push it in that IV, 30 minutes later, my patient has stopped vomiting, and she's feeling better. Now, you do that with a natural remedy, you're gonna need a little bit more. The effect is not gonna be as immediate. So, you know, you're gonna have, and it's just as anything in our society, you want it now, immediately. It's the drive-through, give me my food now. You're not gonna wait for it to be cooked in a special way or whatever. It's the same thing with the drugs. And the pharmaceutical industry, it's, you know, billions of dollars, they're in everything. Mm-hmm. They're in everything. And with that kind of dollars, you can do the research. You know, you can pay who you need to pay to get things passed, and all of that stuff. But as you're right, it's lacking in the herbal community, and I couldn't tell you why. But the most I can think of, it's funding and maybe pushback from Big Pharma. That's, you know, that's just my personal opinion.
Well, I thought he just clobbered the waters a little bit.
You did well.
He did well muddying the waters, didn't he? Yes. But, you know, as I said, there are two distinct communities, and there are lots of different remedies out there. As I said, you have the oilers who, you know, there's essential oil for everything and people who believe in it. You have those who go the chiropractic route and they think, you know, an adjustment will balance them up and take care of all their things. And I won't lie to you. I remember once we drove from here to Longview, and it's an 8-hour drive, and I don't know how I sat in that car, but for the next 2 days, I could hardly move. My back was like, I don't know what happened. And I went to the chiropractor, and he put me in some positions I've never been in before. You know, before I left that place, I'm thinking, this man is so close to me. This is weird. And he said to me, tomorrow, you may not feel much better, but by the next day, your pain should be gone. And he was right. I had taken Motrin, and as I tell you, I believe in drugs. I'll take some Motrin, I'll take some Aleve, I will. And I did, and it did not help my pain. And I went, and that man pushed on my limbs in all sorts of directions, and my pain was gone. So I do believe there is some value in you know, the alignment and the adjustment and all of that. So, but to each his own, you know, and I just think we need to keep an open mind, as Maria said, not everything's gonna work for everybody else. And you stick to what you think will work for you, because believe pill and believe cure, they have this saying to say.
Placebo.
you know, so you have that placebo effect, yes, you do. Any more questions or contributions? No?
Osteopathy is, they do an excellent job with the medical end of it and also the digestive situation. There's another factor that really involved here. As far as big pharma is concerned, they only have to get, period. And I don't think there's any doubt. We need to change our government up and not let them. You see, there's a lot of people that go into Congress, senators and all, that come out millionaires and how they did it. $174,000 a year. Big pharma.
Yeah.
$300,000 to each incident, so to speak. Yeah. And their incidents almost every day.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying it's all bad. Don't get me wrong.
No,
but you're right. Drugs do a wonderful job. And it's too bad we can't get the research on the herbal.
On the herbal. So that it would be good if you could have a balanced option.
Absolutely.
Where you could say, okay, yes, these natural remedies, we have done the research, we know exactly how much of this peppermint is needed to stimulate your gut to move and make you feel better. You know, if we had that option, where it's balanced on both sides, then, it would be a perfect world. But
we can do our part, as we can do some of the natural remedies and prevent. And if it's not really working, then you move further in the treatment. But I think the most important is diagnosis. If you have a good diagnosis, then you know against what you fight. And you can try natural remedies, it's not working, you can go on. Well, in closing, I want to share with you, I spoke with one of the ladies, which is in kind of helping us with the health fair in 2019. And she will come to our church next year in, I think, around March, because we suggest to do the health fair on our grounds and not to go to the convention. And when she comes, she can take the decision if we can do it here or we have to move it to the convention center. But that will be around March when she comes. She will take a look to all what we have here and all the abilities. But if we do it in the church, that will give us a great exposure. People will see who we are, they will see what we have, and they will not be scared to come inside, but we'll take, already we spoke a little bit how to organize it, how to do things, and I think if we start the preparation next year, by God's grace, we'll be ready in May 2019. And she thinks that we can cover 1,000 people in one day, and she believes that we should do it for 9 hours, from 9 to 5, and just keep going, and 1,000 people to be helped, that would be a lot.
This process has been proven in several different areas.
Yes, yes. They had a lot of bio studies because of this, and she liked the idea that night, maybe to start a week of prayer, and as they come to different station, for us to encourage them to come for prayer that night. In that way, we can start a week of prayer. They will be encouraged to come and connect with a church member, and it will be easier. God has different plans how to reach different people, but I hope that when we do the health fair, that God will use each one of us and spread the news. Yes. Well, let's close with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your love. And Lord, we thank you for helping us to understand more about the cold and flu, and help us to see how we can prevent it and how to treat it. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have